The ASU Graduate College continually improves the resources we provide to our graduate students and postdoctoral fellows so that they have the knowledge, dispositions, and skills required to succeed in the 21st century. The ASU Graduate College strives to equip graduate students and postdoctoral fellows with transferable skills that are needed in today's career markets. We are concerned with the so what question about researchers' labor and the knowledge they produce. Why would or should people outside the academy think that research findings matter? What difference is research making in people's lives or in reducing problems or challenges of social significance? Knowledge mobilization is concerned with making the insights and solutions discovered by researchers accessible and usable. How can we document that such knowledge made an impact on the lives of these people? The stories you're about to see illustrate what knowledge mobilization looks like in real life.
The problem that we try to tackle with our work is how can we improve fishing sustainability and also improve or at least maintain the livelihoods of fishermen. Small-scale fisheries are poorly regulated. They incur a lot of what is called bycatch, and bycatch is any animal that gets caught in a fishing net that wasn't intended to be captured. And in Baja, where I work, a lot of the bycatch includes endangered species such as sea turtles, sharks, whales. What really inspired this work for me was when I was a master's student at the University of Florida, I was studying sea turtle biology and I was tracking the movements of sea turtles. You have to look into the eyes of a sea turtle. There's something so spiritual about it. This is an animal that's been around for 200 million years. Over the course of a two-week span, I ended up tracking countless turtles to their deaths. And these turtles were ending up drowning in fishing nets. One day a fisherman came and brought me a turtle that we had been tracking. And I know he could have sold that and gotten a lot of money for that, but instead wanted it to bring it to me. And so I looked at that as an opportunity to engage fishermen and bring them into my research project and make them essentially become part of our team and help us design different solutions that can protect turtles, but also that can improve their livelihoods. And so one day I was out, we were out catching sea turtles and tracking sea turtles, middle of the day, and I saw a sea turtle swim right up to a net, noticed the net, and turned right around. And so that led to my idea to place lights on fishing nets. The LEDs illuminate the net at night, and so it provides a visual cue for the sea turtle to see that net and then avoid becoming entangled in the net. Simply by putting these lights on fishing nets, we caught 50% fewer sea turtles and 95% fewer sharks. What I found though from my PhD research was the batteries only lasted 1 to 2 weeks. And so for the average fisherman, that would have been 200 to 400 AA batteries potentially per week. So what I did was I teamed up with ASU engineers who specialized in solar power and kinetic energy, and I basically asked them, how can we develop a solution to power these lights with renewable energy? That has really helped me mobilize my knowledge, because if I was at a smaller school or a school that didn't advocate for interdisciplinary research like ASU, it would be much harder to do this work. This is the future of fisheries. In 50 years from now, I can imagine every coastal community on this planet fishing with solar-powered nets.
Given my background in kinesiology, I learned a lot about exercise and exercise physiology and the importance of being active in order to maintain health and reduce your risk for diabetes. Energy in equals energy out. And so you look at a problem like obesity and diabetes and just think, man, why can't they exercise more and eat less? This would solve the problem. The problem that we address with our research is diabetes risk in Latino youth and families. Not a whole lot of work has been done around diabetes prevention for the family, specifically for Latino families. Latino youth are disproportionately burdened by diabetes. They are the most insulin-resistant subgroup. Early in 2012, we had actually started partnering with the YMCA to test this intervention. It was a diabetes prevention intervention for Latino adolescents. This was a rigorous clinical trial, and so a very controlled environment, but we did find that the program did lead to significant improvements in diabetes risk. our work is really important in that we take our diabetes prevention programs and we adapt it to the culture. Out of our 160 participants, over 50% of them were coming from Maryvale. As soon as you step into Maryvale, you feel the culture. It's still a close-knit, connected community where the Hispanic-Latino culture is prevalent. And one of the critical values for that culture is family. And so we really saw this need to take this program sort of out of the confines of this rigor and this clinical trial and move it to the community where it's needed. So Viva Maryvale is a family-centered diabetes prevention program for Latino families in Maryvale, Arizona. And it is conducted in partnership with some wonderful community folks here in the Valley, starting with the Valley of the Sun YMCA, who really lends their expertise in fitness instruction, and they serve as the site for the project. Patients are identified and enrolled into the program. They participate in a pre-intervention assessment, which is led by our team here at ASU, and then they enter this 12-week lifestyle intervention, where they go to nutrition education class for one time a week for 60 minutes, and the parents must attend. And there they learn things about fats and carbs, and they set family goals. And then three times a week, they go to a physical activity session, which is led by trained physical activity instructors at the YMCA. And then once the 12-week program is done, we send them back to the medical provider so that they can see their results, talk about their progress through the program, and establish a future plan of care. I think our knowledge exchange with our participants is bidirectional. That feedback is critical for guiding the development of the intervention. We've seen significant reductions in diabetes risk in our adults. For our youth, we've also seen significant reductions in their body composition. And then as a whole, we've seen this improvement in quality of life. We know that there are other vulnerable communities like Maryvale, and we know that the need for diabetes prevention is also statewide. So our vision is that we can reach these communities in other areas throughout the state. To me, knowledge mobilization means taking the knowledge and the research that is generated here in the academic institution, taking it out to the community. For us, the power in our knowledge mobilization is through partnership. And so partnering with the other organizations and community stakeholders who can help us get this knowledge to the folks, get it from the research to the ground and to the folks who are gonna use it.